Everyone, and welcome once again to another panel discussion on Intelligent Automation Democratizing Software Robots. For this session, let me welcome our moderator, Mr. Pramod Agarwal, VP and Regional CTO Automation Anywhere. Our panelists, Mr. Alok Nath Day, Senior Vice President and Chief Technology Officer, Samsung India, Mr. Ashish Srivastav, Head Technology, FSS, Mr. Pankaj Pandit, Chief Information Officer, Oberoi Realty, Mr. Megan Nangaukar, Deputy CIO, Global Delivery, Fujitsu. Dear audience, please ask your questions in the chat box. Our speakers may answer in the end. Welcome to all of you. Over to you, Mr. Agarwal.
Thank you. And thanks to IMA for organizing this session. Very clear that the times that we are going through with COVID are very, very tough. And therefore, every participant who has taken time to come to the session, I'm very excited about and motivated by their presence. And I expect that we'll have some interesting discussion and hope that the audience participates by asking questions so we keep it lively and real. So I'm in good company with four of my sort of professional colleagues here, Dr. Alok Nath, Megan, Pankaj, and Ashish. So, the flow of the conversation would be around automation and specifically how do we democratize automation. And when we talk about automation can mean many things to many people, but in the context of this conversation, it is about automating the human task in interacting with the computers. And these tasks could be data entry tasks. They could be tasks which automate intelligence. As an example, cognitive intelligence is becoming key to end-to-end process automation where any kind of input via data, document, human voice, video can be interpreted by the emerging AI/ML techniques and become part of a fully automated process. So just for the audience sake, this is a discussion about automation. And oftentimes I've heard about what is automation and what is digitization, because a lot of companies have implemented large systems like SAP, Oracle, or homegrown applications, and what is automation? So if you go to a finance function, if you go to operations, supply chain, you will find a lot of effort goes into making a process work on top of the system. So think of digitization as the first step where paper got replaced by computers, and automation as the second step where the human interaction with the computers is getting replaced by the automation bots. So the context is automation, and we are talking here about democratization, which also implies that automation has been emerging in large companies for a number of years, I think especially last 5 to 7 years. But it has come to a point where due to the tech literacy of our employees, and you can think of people who have grown up since the late 90s, or early 2000s, they're very tech literate. They're not afraid of working with and participating in and producing these bots. So we are dealing with a tech literate population. We are dealing with systems which are highly digitized today. All kind of human interaction is getting digitized. And therefore automation becomes the next step in elevating the enterprise productivity as well as ability of the enterprise to be more creative and be more competitive out there. So with that, my first question to the panelists, and I will request all the panelists to maybe introduce themselves before they get to the topic. The first question that I want to ask all of my panelists is, we talk a lot about automation, and many companies have very scaled deployments of automation. Up to the level of thousands of bots running. But still, automation has remained largely technical in most of the organizations. And I know that tech companies like Samsung, Fujitsu, they deal with this day in and day out with within themselves and outside of their universe. So what would be some of the tips or tricks to making automation more transformative and not tactical? And any examples from either automation domain or other domain would be useful in understanding how do you really make this technology go quote-unquote viral. So let me start with Dr. Alok, and then we'll move to Dr. Ashish in the name order, then Mr. Megan, and then Pankaj. So Dr.
Thank
Alok,
you.
With you, please.
Thanks to IAMI and Pramoda for introducing the topic. I think we have been having many different sessions on this automation. Myself, Alok, I'm as CTO role for Samsung in India based out of Bangalore. I combine the 5G camera, multimedia, and IoT activities as an overall responsibility for in-house innovations combined with open innovations. And in particular, I am more responsible to create a COE between Korea and here in the intersection space of AI, IoT, and big data. So that's my specialty. Coming to the topic, you know, we talk about this cyber physical systems and robots working around, and that's very physical. But here we are talking software robots, which is, in other words, bots. So there is no physical or hardware element in it. And as you said, you know, the automation is very, very vital. On one hand, many bots are there, but some of the people are struggling to absorb it, and why should I use it, and that kind of situations. So for me, it's very simple. We use it for two different reasons. Either it's a business productivity, business value that comes, and therefore we would find opportunity to bring these bots. And I'm not even coming to the democratization part, maybe that's later, but just the bots. Or the second, we are a consumer electronics company, so if I can bring consumer experience higher, then I would love to also bring certain automations there. So let me give examples. So for example, an employee in an enterprise, there is HR services, there is IT services, and many of these L1 activities that are quite mundane could be replaced and very happily replaced, because I don't think as human we are enjoying that part of it. And I generally joke around and I say, you know, the RPA's biggest competitor is the coffee machine or the coffee companies, because we used to do all these mundane work and then you need a break to have coffees, and now you don't need the breaks, so you might be, coffee business might be more affected. But jokes apart, I think the important part is if I am connecting a mobile to a laptop and enterprise connectivity, would it work automatically? If I'm connecting an audio file, and today I try to play in audio player, and I see it says, you know, the format mismatch, right? But if you think about the components of it, you have to detect that this format is not playable. You have to detect a software part of it. There are tons of libraries that tells that you convert from this format to that format. And then you just play. So what do you do manually? I am doing manually this format transformations and then go to playing. But this is a macro that simply can be combined, auto detections, conversions, playing, one click, it does it. And I don't think we lose anything in that. We get more joy out of it that in one click, it has happened. Right. So that's one kind of examples. The other example in the consumer electronics domain, if I want to give, we talk about IoT. There are tons of devices people are buying and they're trying to connect. Now, it's a humongous task for people to know the details and get the Wi-Fi password, get the cloud credentials, and then try to connect them. What is very simple, if we have a Samsung account, we know when you purchase that what are the devices that you have. And therefore, as soon as you bring them and you try to connect, you have a smartphone, we can detect pair through the Bluetooth BLE. And then we pass the Wi-Fi router details. We get the cloud credentials, bring it, pass it on, and it is on automatic process. It may take a couple of minutes, but I don't need to worry about it. I do all the authentications, but then you are connected to deliver and you can onboard. So the layman who would not like to know, who cannot learn that much, is just a joy. So beyond that consumer experience, it's more than the experience. It is about, otherwise they'd be afraid of bringing these devices and trying to connect. I don't know how to connect, and therefore let's stay away. And as we grow this number, this is going to be significant. And then I can take it to authentications and other kind of directions. So I think this is two examples that I wanted to give, one from enterprise and one from consumer electronics, where we are using it. And we could come back to what are the kind of bots and what are the benefits maybe in the next round.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Alok, for jumping right in. A couple of takeaways from your thoughts were, one was, I think this L1 conversation itself can be digitized, and therefore you get much more insights into the customer interaction with the corporations, and therefore you can do a lot more with that data to be more proactive and more predictive about solving problems. And the other one that's also very interesting is from your experience of how do you work with the edge devices. And really, edge devices are really multiplying, I think, by an order of magnitude every year. And therefore, how do you provide that superlative experience with automation is very, very interesting idea. And I think we can talk about the automation anywhere technology later. But let me come to Mr. Ashish, who's been waiting. Mr. Ashish, over to you. I think the question is pretty clear.
Perfect. So myself, Ashish Srivastava, heading the technology in financial software and system. Carry around 23 years of experience in multi-domain industries, manufacturing, retail, telecom, media, education, and government sector also. Before this financial software and system, I was head of CTO for the Punjab state government also. So I'll give you two aspects. One is from the banking and payment industry, and second aspect from the government sector. So let's start with the payment side. So we are a payment technology service provider. We carry around approximately 20 plus different product IPs. We have around 2000 payment professional, technology professional. We have 100 plus global customers on banking side. We are running approximately 40,000 ATM operations. Every month, we are processing around 1 billion reconciliation every month on our system. So you can understand from this that the kind of large scale operation we are managing, which is not possible if you don't have automation, things are in place. I can say that the payment industry works on the mainly the six verticals. I can say that. Like one is the core banking system where you have reconciliation and the banking operation is there. Second aspect is the manufacturer of ATM, point of sale solution, micro ATM and other devices. Third aspect is the managed services, so who manages the ATM operations, CRAs and different those things are there. Post is the issuance, which you have a prepaid instruments and credit cards, and this is there. And support services, which can comes to analytics and the kind of a CRM solutions and kind of different analytics you are performing. In all these six processes, you can see that the different processes which you are running across, like the payment reconciliations, AR, AP, everywhere the finance industries come with a rank, I can say that 25 to 30% things are already automated. And the way the open banking and finance companies are going now, the open architecture and the kind of API integration, the banking itself is coming as a bank as a services, where the platform-based architecture is coming up and bank is coming up integrating with different services. When you are automatized these things, the bank is giving you services when every day the payment and payment sector and the mobile internet is going everywhere. This technology has to be automated at every places, and we are doing those integration on those technologies like demand and supplies. Right now, the government policies are coming up that financial inclusion should become in place. If you see that Indian market is still We are only digitized, although we say that we are digitizing everywhere, but you can see only the 2% are in the global transaction. We are carrying only less than 2 or 3% transaction in the worldwide. So how this financial inclusion will come into the rural area, tier 3, tier 4 cities, how the demand supply can come up, these financial services are related to banking, banking, investments, insurance, and different sectors of finance, how we can leverage those things is possible when you integrate a various system and provide this thing. So we are working towards that, and maybe very soon you will hear from us that how we are leveraging this technology to leverage, to take care to tier 3 and tier 4 cities level. And cash in, cash out can be possible. So with this automation things, like you can give a simple example of Kenya, where the non-banking system, M-Pesa, is having 10 times customers in any bank in the Kenya. So which is non-banking sector, but having the complete most of created a different economy in those aspects. So the automation things we are using in those aspects. Government side, I can say, various example where government is trying to do a kind of automation, like simple example, which I also drive in Punjab state. We have 60,000 kilometers roads, which we want to do a resurvey and do the complete, where the roads, new roads needs to build, where the patch management has to be done. So this is the complete process we automated, and while the recognition technology that where the patches are there and how much cost you required for that particular patch enable, this complete survey and calculation of the cost requirement is then completely automated system. In government sector, we have like 50 departments, 80 different applications, how the government is giving different benefits to the respective departments, like you have subsidies for farmers. There is the farmers in land records having maybe a more than 10 acres, whatever land record is there, but there's a subsidy we can give to only the 4 acre or less than that is there. So how you can interoperability can be created in different system and automate those schemes so you can have a complete control on the system. The smart city project, either where you are working on the water management system or sewage management system or the waste management system, or you have a parking management system or surveillance system. Everywhere, the IoT, as my colleague already said, that the IoT devices is coming and how this automation come in place and central surveillance can be taken up those things. So there are n number of examples which right now the government is taking on the automation place. And I can say that the software robot is not a product, it's a service. So how you will utilize that, it every organization has a different use case. Number 6-7 industries, all industry I use this automations, either it's manufacturing or retail products and inventory management or warehouse management solutions. Everywhere I used automation and transformed the companies on those aspects. Maybe other-
Thank you, Mr.
Second.
So essentially your focus is on looking at very large scale systems, whether it's billions of say banking users or whether it is a large hardware or physical systems, and you're automating those, and that's the transformative power of the automation technology. I think that's a point very well made. Mr. Megan, I'll have to probably request you to limit your comments, say 3 minutes or so, though I think it's unfair because I didn't put the limits to Ashish and Alok, but I'll set their time in the next question, I promise.
I think both Alok and Ashish had very interesting examples to share, and whatever time they took, it was very valuable from that perspective. So let me touch upon a slightly different aspect of automation. I think we are into a services industry. We provide services to hundreds and thousands of customers across the world. Majority portion of our business is also dependent on our employees being available and being able to provide those services in the best possible manner. To us, a lot of our automation related story internally focuses on how do we make our employees life in the organization very easy. As in, imagine the scenario that majority of those employees spend 90-95% of their time working for an organization which is not their employer. They're constantly connected into customer systems. They're providing solutions and services to them. If what they do for Fujitsu or internally for us becomes very easy for them, it's almost an analogy of when you're driving on a highway, if you don't have to look into your rear view mirror every 2 seconds or 3 seconds to see what's happening behind you, you're likely to run, have a very, very smooth and quick ride on a highway, correct? And for our employees, for their journey to be smooth, they need to have the least amount of hurdles and hassles and need to look into the organization per se on a daily basis. So what does that mean then? So you have to look at use cases where do they interface with us? Any activity that they perform, is it available almost in a self-service fashion? If that answer has to be yes, then you need to go back and look at all of your provisioning activities, whether it is finance department services or facilities, IT, connectivity, networks, wherever you could make it available at the touch of a button or click of a link, employees are likely to be able to spend that much more time and effort and focusing on the customers that they're servicing. So for us, that entire story of automation to that extent is a very unique combination of very tactical use case scenarios, but all woven into a much larger picture, which is almost common across 100 plus countries that we operate in, because the nature of work remains same.
Wonderful. I think so.
How we try to approach it.
So in a way, you're talking about, even though the sort of the contribution of the automation technology in itself for an employee may seem tactical, but when it is available to everybody and everybody is able to work at a much higher productivity level, that in brings transformational effects to the journey.
Absolutely.
So maybe I'll bake this into a second question as well to you, Megan, which is, when you democratize the technology, are there one or two key points that an organization should take into account? And you're a technology organization, so I think evangelizing a technology is easier, but I would still like to hear from you, what did you think as to the one or two key points?
So, as in, it's a unique word. We're trying to. When I thought about this particular aspect of how do you democratize this, as in the first thought process that came to my mind was how we use Excel today. Some point of time years ago, when it was built as a tool, you would have people go through a training to really learn what to do and how to do it. Today, more often than not, you would have business side employees doing very advanced work on Excel than even technology teams. So that's the kind of simile which came to my mind. And I think while we are definitely not there, I mean, let's be very honest that we are not yet there. But the key things that would probably help us go in that direction, if I was to point out one or two items, one word that comes to my mind is co-creation. And within our organization, we use this word very heavily, that almost everything that we do has to have a some kind of a human-centric view. And co-creation is another area where almost every problem that we try to solve, there has to be a way of co-creating that solution rather than a team sitting somewhere in the corner of the organization trying to solve it for someone else. It does not work. So that's one area, and we can talk about it later at more detail maybe. The other thing I think which is very important is that, when we talk about bots, the power in this particular technology comes with the fact that this automation is almost non-invasive. As in, automation has been around for a long time, but we would use programmatic approaches, software coding to tie things together and run these workflows, correct? When we talk about, say, RPAs and bots, we are essentially building a layer on what exists today and making it easier to operate, making it faster to operate. Correct? You can take it off anytime you want. The core systems don't change. Their flows don't necessarily have to change.
Right.
That's the power of this particular wave of automation, so to say. Now, if that really has to be then successful, I think what most organizations need to look at is that even today, if the team in the office requires stationery, they go to a shelf and there is a repository of various types of stationery. They see markers of different colors, pens, folders, files, or it could be a person who's handing it over to them. But that's the way it works, correct? Now, is it possible for us to have a like a provisioning COE, for lack of a better word, in the organization, which kind of creates a base framework,
correct,
of bots.
To put the guardrails.
Yeah, it just allows things to be available. And then anyone who wants to consume it just goes, puts a request, consumes it, is able to easily validate whether what they want to do is worth it or not, and then take it to a larger scale adoption. I think these two areas, to me, probably would make a big difference in taking it to a next level.
Thank you. Those are very brilliant points about co-creation and helping the co-creation, because not everybody may be still be comfortable with this. And we have products like private bot stores, which enable this kind of collaboration within the enterprise. And an Australian media company did some of what you said. And it was pretty interesting for me to hear their case study where, even though these were like designers and artists, they were doing so much work with the digital tools and they were wasting so much time on the working with digital tools that automation helped them with 30-odd% of increased productivity, the time available to work on real creative work. So that was an amazing story. Mr. Pankaj, coming to you, I think my main question remains the same, but now there's two audience questions which I think maybe the second one is about automation technology. How can small companies leverage this and create value? So, Mr. Pankaj, if you can talk about the general thinking around automation as a transformative force and how can small companies leverage this, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah, sure. So my name is Pankaj Pandit and I am CIO for Obera Reality. So we are basically developers. We build homes for the people. Of course, we are also into commercial and retail. And so when we are talking about automation, I am right now not talking about home automation or, you know, how to build smart homes or smart communities. I would rather look at how I can use robotic processes to improve operations of our organization. That's the perspective I would like to touch upon. So if you ask me, RPA is here to stay. It is going to grow. And I believe every organization sooner or later will have to embrace it simply because of the advantages it offers. Now, for us, I just use my experience also in this RPA and what we are doing at Obera Reality. Obviously, the first target is to automate the mundane processes where there is not much human intelligence necessary to, you know, run the process successfully. This is the typical use case. I am sure anybody who is touching RPA will start with this. And then you can, of course, go beyond and handle more and more complex processes. So we have automated a few of our accounting processes to start with. We are also implementing workflows in our engineering processes and all that. So one aspect that it directly gives is it obviously reduces your the manpower involvement in getting this mundane processes done. It brings the accuracy. It brings the consistent results those we all look forward to. So that aspect is clear. But when it comes to democratization of these processes, we have to look at the people angle. And I'm not sure how other organizations or the people who just spoke now, like Megan and all, have seen this. The when you try to get this to the people, okay, this process I'm trying to automate, that process I'm trying to automate, there is always a fear factor that comes along. What will happen to my job in that case? And when one tries to build a business case around RPA, management wants to know how many, headcounts will be impacted because of this automation. They want to reduce the operational expenditure. And then, so what we did is, we have not built the case around headcount reduction. And this is something which I wanted to share with the forum. Wonderful. The business case that we could build around was that this powers the growth of the organization. In the sense, first of all, it brings operational efficiencies, those not seen till now, and especially in this environment where we are battling with COVID and all that, people working from home. I have around 15 bots running in the organization, where we are able to handle multiple such processes which would have been difficult to handle had the people been needed to execute those. So this is about making company future ready. This is about making people look forward to higher roles, ditch the routine mundane roles which can be anyway robotized, and also make company ready for handling situations like COVID, where the people dependency is lower and you get repetitive, consistent results. So by and large, we have seen that, answering Pramod's question directly. So when I look at a small scale organization, we have found that deploying RPA is not very expensive. It is not like you have to invest tons of money to get going on this RPA journey. Point number two is, it's a journey. You have to start somewhere. You start with mundane processes and then go on to more and more complex, and you will definitely benefit from this technology per se. And the third point I will try to make here is that this definitely brings value in terms of quality that you get from the robots. And it saves company a lot of headaches because of some inadvertent mistakes that an employee may make. For example, filing returns or typing a GST number.
Yep.
Now, these kind of mistakes can turn into a big problems for the organization. These problems are avoided by using RPA because you get very, very dependable results. So on these three counts, because we have just started the journey, so I don't want to kind of run ahead of myself and talk something which I haven't experienced. But this is what we have been doing right now, and we have definitely seen results. And the last point, I will just repeat myself again, that we have not built our business case around headcount reduction.
That's wonderful, Pankaj. And we are seeing that post-COVID, that has become quite the trend, that people are thinking about. Yes. Business resiliency. I mean, you think about small companies where you may not have specialists for each role, and one person may be doing multiple jobs. It makes even more sense to do automation because it can bring inherent resiliency to the organization and ability of an organization to work as if they are a very large organization. I think they can mimic. Absolutely. The behaviors of a large organization, even though they're small, with the help of these technologies. Alok, I'll come back. Absolutely. To you. And there is a question from the audience that I think you are well suited to respond to. How do you look at automation in conjunction with AI and ML? And the question is, does that make more sense to think of these two as together, complementary technologies? And if you have any examples from the enterprise or your own world of consumer electronics, that would be wonderful.
Okay, thank you. So I think when the RPA process started, obviously, even if you do not have any AI or ML, if it's a rule-based, it can qualify as a process automation. That's how it got started. But as I highlighted in my example of audio player, you are detecting, which is an intelligence, a simple intelligence example, but it is an intelligence that this is not matching, and therefore I need to play. Now you can grow that algorithm of AI ML to be a very sophisticated one for a particular purpose, because suppose you want to understand whether the person is deeply sleeping and therefore you will do something, or otherwise if he's waking up. Now that algorithm of waking up or deep sleep can be a quite sophisticated one. So the degree of AI ML can be an independent process, and that can stand on its own, and RPA also can stand on its own. But when you kind of combine the power of if something happens, then something will be done, that IFTTT, as we call it, that if conditions can be quite powerful, and that's where you apply your AI ML. The actions part of it could be quite straightforward, because that's an action, right? Directly, you turn this light, you do something, you connect this, you change the format, that's an actions.
That's a wonderful analogy.
Yeah, that's the part that I wanted to highlight in response to the questions. And also, I think one more point I want to highlight is it's not that full RPA has to be and fully automated. You know, there could be a human intervention, because suppose you did something and you reach to a point of ambiguity, which cannot be dealt today by an AI schemes or otherwise, then you could throw that question, somebody clicks one more button, and then you go for the second phase of automation. So you can break that, and you have your chat bot, you have your web crawling bot, you have all kinds of automations that can help in human this thing. So that's my first part of the question. And since you have been talking about the democratization, just to build upon it a little bit.
You have exactly 60 seconds and then 60 seconds for Ashish.
Sure. So the main point is, you know, I don't think we have reached to that particular stage. We should be doing more bottom up and small scale things and non-invasive. I think you said that, non-frictional. We don't want to lose jobs. So whatever is mundane, whatever is algorithmic, if we go that way, I think we are able to convince people on the way and build a bigger system. And as you said, you know, even if 10,000 employees do a small thing at the organization level, it is big. And as Pankaj said, you know, it should be treated more like a growth engine rather than replacing. What else can we do as we do operational efficiency? So it will take time, and there are a lot of open source tools and trainings that are getting available. So I'm sure, you know, people need to learn through that and be ready to do more of that high level of automations.
Though my infomercial is that use automation anywhere, not open source. I'm just kidding here.
Yeah, I know UiPath and WorkFusion and many others have created some of these solutions, but I think that's also something that people are looking for. Yeah. If we can get from the source, then maybe it's easy to apply and try it out.
Ashish, exactly 60 seconds on democratizing, and I'll close, I promise. Yeah. You're on mute, Ashish.
So I can say that when you want to go to the large scale, everything is now is coming as a services. So I'll request partner like you, and I am sure the 100 partners like you is available in the market as on date. How you can pre-trained models will come as a services for like small scale markets, how you can use the low code platform, how you can use our predefined parameters that the bots are readily available. You're automating processes. Why can't you automate your bots also? And sale is a market for the smaller segments who can't afford the high skill sets of data scientists and the AI ML and those things. Intelligent automation is basically a combination of RPA, workflow automation, business process reengineering, conversational AI, and those, this combining, when you combining these things, then the intelligence automation come in place. The organization strategy should be changed, and you are giving me very less time, otherwise I can say 10 things also. So this is a summary I can say.
Next time I may have, will have to give us 2 hours for this conversation, and that's what I would request. But I think I had a great time. I learned a lot. I think several key points came out with respect to democratizing about co-creation, assisting co-creation through models like what you said, Ashish, having an empowered COE, building pre-built templates that can help We also have tools like Discovery Bar that can help discover what the person is doing, especially for small scale and mid-size, which cannot afford developers. They can use Discovery Bots to discover the process and then build the templates from the tool itself. So their capabilities like the develop, but I think largely, I think my takeaway is think value and then transformative results will happen. I think that's my summary of today's conversation. With that, I again want to thank all of you. I think you've been wonderful, very insightful comments on these questions. With that, IMAI team, I'd like to thank you again, and over to you.
Thank you to all the amazing Mr. Day, Mr. Srivastav, Mr. Pandit, and Mr. Nandgaonkar. Thank you to our moderator, Mr. Agrawal, for keeping the discussion relevant, significant, and so exciting. Thanks to our title partner, Accenture, Track partner, Automation Anywhere, Cloud Communication partner, Root Mobile, Bronze partner, Tata Teleservices, and Knowledge partner, PwC. Stay tuned for a lot more. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you all.